Good morning, brothers and sisters, visiting friends, and those who are listening to us on the air. We welcome you to this morning's worship. Let us quiet our hearts as we prepare to meet God by singing the hymn 248, Ye Servants of God. Continue this morning's worship as we respond appropriately. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wonderful works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Wonderful works he has done, his miracles and the judgment he has uttered, of offspring of his servant Abraham, children of Jacob, his chosen one. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He is mindful of his covenant forever, of the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations, the covenant that he made with Abraham, his sworn promise to Isaac, confirmed to Jacob as a statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as your portion for an inheritance. Together, O God, the Holy Spirit, come to us and among us. Come as the wind and cleanse us. Come as the fire and burn. Come as the dew and refresh. Covet, convert, and consecrate many hearts and lives. Great good, and to the great glory And this we ask for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. God, in whom we move and have our being, you know us, love us, and sustain us. We praise you for your goodness and thank you for your care. You created the world and all that is in it. You knitted us together in our mother's womb. You made us male and female in your image. You made each one unique and individual, unique for relationship with you, unique in the talents and gifts we have to serve you. Holy is your name. You are from eternity to eternity. There is none like you. Blessed be in your name forever and ever. Amen. Merciful and gracious God, our hearts cry out for you to make us whole again. Even as we celebrate that you have come to dwell within us, we have sinned against you and abandoned your commandment. We have been jealous, possessive, ambivalent, and impulsive. We have not heeded your words, and we have not cherished your covenant. Help us to glorify you in all times and in all places. As our souls thirst for your living water, quench our need and satisfy our love, that we may come back to you and be sent forth to fill the world with your mercy and grace. Your Spirit is here, your church is born, and the day of the Lord is coming. You have gathered all people together in your Spirit, and you have brought life to all valleys of death. Still, O Lord, we cannot trust you, for we fear our bones are beyond repair. Still, O Lord, we turn away, for we fear our hope is lost. Still, O Lord, we imagine isolation, for we fear we are cut off from your presence. Forgive us, Holy One, as you did for the first church. Breathe the fire of life into us, as you did for the prophet Ezekiel. Reveal to us your life-giving presence. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, who is at work within us. Amen. God, bring us new life when our bones are dry, and hope when we are hopeless. God, washes us in mercy, and ignite us with the Spirit. By the grace of God, through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free. Amen. Thanks be to God. At this time, we continue as we sing hymn 276, Sometimes a Light Surprises. Let us stand and sing hymn 276.
Come for sun declining, he grows.
and rejoice, and we come before God to give thanks. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we humbly thank you for your goodness to us and to all that you have made. We praise you for your creation, for keeping us and all things in your care, and for all the blessings of life. Above all, we bless you for your immeasurable love in redeeming the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awesome awareness of your mercies that with thankful hearts we praise you, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving ourselves to your service and by living in your gift of holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all worship and praise, now and forevermore. Amen. We turn to the ministry of the word as we prayerfully read the collect for today, followed by the epistle reading from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. Let us read together. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we pray, and to give more than either we desire or deserve. Pour down upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those things which we are not worthy to ask, but through the merits and meditation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Let us listen to the epistle reading taken from Romans 14, 1 to 12.
Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or your sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks.
We continue as we stand and sing, stand up for Jesus. Hymn number 339.
Stand up. My brothers and sisters, I greet you in the name of Jesus the Christ. We thank God this morning for the opportunity given to us to assemble before Him, to bring our praise and thanksgiving to Him. You know, God has been so faithful to us. Even in the midst of all the challenges, the trials of life, we are still on the land of the living. God has ordained us to be alive. And therefore, we want to thank God for life. We want to thank you for coming out to worship this morning. And also our brothers and sisters worshiping from home. We thank God for your life. And we pray that the good Lord will continue to bless all of us. Let us bow our heads as we approach God in prayer. And so, Lord, this morning, we bow our heads, raise our hearts to offer our praise and thanksgiving to you. We thank you, O God, for your goodness and mercies which has followed us all the days of our lives. We are blessed, O God, to be in your presence this morning. The psalmist says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of God, because in the presence of God, there is liberty and freedom. So, Lord, we want to thank you for this opportunity to be in your presence, the King of all the kings. So we commit our act of worship at this time, especially as your word is coming to us. Father, we ask, O God, that you open our hearts, our understanding, that even as the word is coming, it will find root and place in our heart. Father, as I stand before your people, Father, I seek your wisdom, your knowledge, your understanding, to be able to expound the meaning of your word. Lord, you know I cannot do it without you. And therefore, I ask your Holy Spirit to minister to me so that I will be able to minister to your people. So let the words of my mouth, the meditation of our heart, be pleasing and acceptable unto you, God. We bless you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I'm reading from Romans chapter 14, verse 1 to 4. That is our text for reflection this morning. Romans chapter 14, 1 to 4. And it reads, welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. And those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Verse 4. Who are you to pass judgment on servant of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. My brothers and sisters, our theme for today is be tolerant in a culture of intolerance. Be tolerant in a culture of intolerance. My brothers and sisters, the Christian love calls on us to embrace each other, irrespective of the background of the person. As Christian, we need to embrace each other. It is unfortunate today. It seems we live in a restless, violent, ever-changing world that moves in unknown directions every day. It appears many people are losing their cool as a result of hardship that COVID-19 pandemic has brought into our world, of which our society is no exception. There is a clear evidence that there is a lack of tolerance in our society today. Today we witness in the society violence. We witness hostility in some people's reaction. We witness vengeance, intemperate language on talk shows, verbal abuse, shooting, killings, all because there is lack of tolerance in our society. And for me, my brothers and sisters, the lack of tolerance is the result of the fear and ignorance towards the unknown. The truth of the matter is, we all have our unique characteristics and personalities that makes us different from each other. As people, we need to appreciate that we are all different in many ways and can be identified in many ways. We are different in gender, different in age, physical characteristics, sexual orientation, personality, hobbies, standard of living, beliefs, and the list could go on and on. Because of these differences, tolerance is what we need to build a friendly and accommodating society. It should be the bedrock of the society to bring progress for all of us. The point I'm making this morning is, we can only advance as a society when we recognize that we share a common destiny in spite of our differences. This is why tolerance is so important in our society. As a society, we must value tolerance. We must respect each other and accept others to move our family forward, to move our country forward, to move our society forward. My brothers and sisters, this is important and necessary in order to have peace, freedom and safety, and mutual respect in our society. Our society today is breeding from intolerance. Our society today is breeding from violence. Intolerance, my brothers and sisters, breeds hatred. Hatred leads to distrust, and distrust causes disunity in every society. Intolerance in our society has the potential to bring infighting and violence. If people are unable to tolerate each other, they become angry and frustrated. In a society filled with hate, a person begins to feel suffocated and depressed. My brothers and sisters, today, intolerance is destroying marriages. It is breaking families into pieces. It is destroying relationships and also destroying our young people's life in a society. It is time to move away from a culture of intolerance and give way to tolerance. My brothers and sisters, it is in this light that we, the Christians, this changing society, should lead the way, setting an example of tolerance in the society. We can welcome every individual, even if we cannot condone their lifestyles or accept their point of view. As Christian community, we are invited to promote tolerance in a culture of intolerance. Living in a Christian community calls us to be far more than tolerant of people who hold different views from each other. My brothers and sisters, so in our text, Paul pleads with the Roman Christians to tolerate each other. He pleads for mutual acceptance. He challenges those who are strong in faith to accept those who are weak in faith. When Paul says, welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions, Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. And those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servant of another? It is before their own Lord that we stand or fall. My brothers and sisters, if you look at the context of this text, Paul was addressing a tension between the Jewish Christians and the Gentiles who have now become Christians. In fact, there were some Jewish Christians that were so radical. They insisted that Gentiles converts should abide by the traditional of the Jewish law. The tension was about keeping the law, eating meat, and keeping certain days as holy. Keeping certain days as holy. With this controversy, the Apostle Paul writes this letter and words to the church in Rome to remind the Jewish Christians of their acceptance, of their unity, and respect for their differences in the minor practices of faith. My brothers and sisters, Paul was so concerned about the unity of the church, and for that matter, the society. What Paul is calling here is genuine tolerance. Paul wants acceptance to be genuine, with no hidden agenda or strange attached. My brothers and sisters, with this background, today, God through Paul is inviting all of us to accept people in spite of their differences. We will always have our differences, but we need to do our best to tolerate each other. We need to treat people with respect and dignity. You see, tolerance allows people of different backgrounds, religions, and races to work and live together. And this breeds unity. True tolerance, involving treating other people and viewpoint with respect and discussing differences, even while holding on to the truth. We should tolerate all people so long as they do not harm to others in thoughts, in words, or deeds. My brothers and sisters, we are to affirm other people regardless of what they do in life. Tolerance creates a society in which people can feel valued and respected, and in which there is room for every person, each with their own ideas, thoughts, and dreams. My brothers and sisters, this is why I think tolerance is important for our society today. It is an essential aspect of a healthy, livable society. Living in a Christian community, it calls us to be tolerant. Christian love calls on us to embrace each other so that we can build a better society for ourselves. So in the text, Paul outlined three things or three areas that we can use to address intolerance in the church and by extension society. So Paul pointed out three things. The first thing that Paul draws our attention is that we must learn to accept one another because God makes us acceptable. So the first thing that we can use to bridge the culture of intolerance is to accept one another just as God has accepted us. So if you look at the text, Paul says, welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over the opinions. So here you could see Paul is saying that in spite of our differences, we should welcome each other. In other words, we should accept each other no matter our differences. So the first thing that Paul is drawing to our attention is that we need to accept one another. And if you look at the word accept, it means to tolerate, to accept one who is weak in faith is to agree and to disagree, to extend welcome, receive into one's home or circle of acquaintances. So the truth is, because God has accepted you and I, in spite of all our weaknesses, in spite of our respective backgrounds, in spite of our sinful nature, the same way we should accept or welcome others. Today, God is calling you and I to receive those who are weak in faith, to receive those who are different from us, to receive those who cannot support themselves. We need, my brothers and sisters, to accept them. We need to support the weak, to love the weak, to be kind to the weak, to help strengthen the weak, and do all within our power to lead them back to Christ. Today, my brothers and sisters, we are encouraged to be kind towards one another and tender-hearted. We are encouraged to welcome, to accept, love as God has loved us and as God has accepted us. My brothers and sisters, from today, let us free from the influences of tradition, denomination, legalism, exclusivity, and grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, knowing that we are all members of the same body whose head is Jesus the Christ. My brothers and sisters, so I want you to remember that in order to tolerate each other, there must be acceptance and welcoming. The second thing that Paul draws to our attention from the text is that we must learn to live by faith and thanksgiving because we all belong to God. We must learn to live by faith with thanksgiving because all of us, we belong to God. So if you look at verse 5 to 9 of our text, Paul is saying, some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced, look at the word convinced, in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. Verse 8 says, if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and of the living. So here, according to Paul, we are responsible for living by faith, not Christian traditions, not Christian rules and regulations, but we must live by faith. The traditions and the rules and the regulation made by man is killing the church. It's killing the church. So Paul is saying that we need to live by conviction. In other words, by faith. These things never save us. It is only through faith that we are saved. So do not eat this. Do not go to this place. Do not worship. All these things will never save. It is only through faith in Jesus Christ that saves. So faith alone. Faith is about confidence. It is not confidence in something. Faith is not confidence in a day of worship. Faith is not confident about what you eat or drink, but faith is confidence in God and God alone. So faith is confidence in Jesus Christ and his promises. It is a confidence in Jesus Christ and what he has done, what he is doing and will do in the future. That matters most. It is not about what you eat, what you drink, and the day of worship and those things. Those are man-made traditions. We need faith to save us. Today, God, through Paul, is encouraging us to live our lives for the Lord with thanksgiving. When we observe days and eat, we do so for the Lord. When we choose not to eat, we do so for the Lord. Thanksgiving should characterize the Christian action. Christ died and rose again that we might also live. That is what we need. Not just minor traditions of eating certain food or certain meat or worship in a particular day. All these things cannot save you. It will not save. Let us remember, we don't live or die for ourselves. We live and die for Christ. So let us understand, we are responsible for living for the Lord. Christ took the responsibility to live and die for all of us. And faith should guide our convictions. We can live by faith today, my brothers and sisters, and every day. So we need to accept each other. That is what Paul is saying. And secondly, we need to live by faith and give thanks to God. And finally, we must not judge one another, because God will be the final judge. So Paul is saying that we should not judge people based on human traditions and the laws and the days of worship and other things. It is only God who judges. So if you look at verses 10 and 12, Paul asks a very important question. When he says, why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. So why should you go around judging people? So today, we are called to stop judging others. Judging others is not good. Therefore, we must stop. You see, because of judgment, we judge people. Because of that, some people today, they find it difficult to go to church. Because you go to church and there are a lot of judges. We don't need judges in church. Go to the law court. We don't need judges in church. People who come to church just to judge people, their clothing, the type of dress they wear, and what have you. My brothers and sisters, no one has the right to judge others, because we are all guilty of sin. We all sin in one way or the other. We are all part of the same family of God, and therefore we should not judge one another. We are all brothers and sisters. We are all relatives by the virtue of our common relationship with Christ. We have the same Father. That is why sometimes we pray our Father who art in heaven. We have the same Savior, Jesus Christ our Lord. We have the same Holy Spirit living and dwelling in us. We have been saved by the same blood, the blood of Jesus. My brothers and sisters, only God has the right to judge others. The moment we judge, then we are assuming the position of God. It is only God who knows the heart of every man, woman. And therefore, when we begin to judge each other, then we are assuming the position of God. It is not the Christian's job description to go around judging evil of other Christians. Let us leave it to God. Judgment is part of God's job description. It is not our job to judge other Christians. It is not your job. It is not my job. It is only God who judges. God has not created you and me to go around judging everybody that you meet. You see, when we judge others, we are saying that they are stupid. They are ignorant. They are not part of God's kingdom. We make ourselves God. Judgment destroys relationship in the church and that of the society. And it will tear the unity of the church and the society. When we judge one another, we are breaking God's commandment. We are breaking God's law. So Paul calls us today to stop judging others because of our relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. So my brothers and sisters, in conclusion, the question is, are you a tolerant person? Let us remember today, we are called to be tolerant in a society of intolerance. We can promote tolerance when we begin to accept each other, when we live by faith with thanksgiving to God, when we stop judging others. We need to teach our children not just how to live together, but how to act together as citizens of this nation, how to tolerate each other at school and in community. We need to nurture tolerance by promoting cultural understanding and respect from our leaders right down to the least in the society. Our leaders should show example. We need to stand against growing inequality and reject social exclusion based on gender, disabilities, sexual orientation, and ethnic or religious background. My brothers and sisters, today as Christian community, we are to love each other, praying for one another, encouraging one another, forgiving one another, greeting one another, showing hospitality to one another. So let us remember that we need to be tolerant in a culture of intolerance. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Let us bow our heads as we reflect on these words. Are you a tolerant Christian? How do you treat people? Do you affirm others? Or you always try to criticize and judge others? In order to overcome the culture of intolerance, God is inviting us today to accept each other, or to welcome, and also to live by faith, not the traditions, rules, and regulations. And also, my brothers and sisters, God wants us to avoid judgmental attitude. How often do you judge others based on your prejudices? Let us ask God to forgive us, that from today onwards, we will accept each other. We will live by faith and avoid the attitude of judgment. And so, Lord, we want to thank you for reminding us this morning that even in the culture of intolerance, we can bring change by accepting one another, their differences, by live our lives by faith, and do away with judgmental attitude. Father, our strength, our wisdom, our knowledge alone cannot do it. And therefore, Lord, we ask you to give us the strength, the wisdom that we need in order to accept each other. In order, oh God, to live our lives by faith and stop attitude of judgmental behavior and embrace each other. So Lord, let your Holy Spirit give us the strength. If there is division in our families, if there is divisions in our homes, in our communities, in our society, oh God, we will never see peace and progress. And therefore we ask you to give us the boldness to accept each other so that, Lord, we'll have a peaceful society to live in. We want to thank you, gracious Lord, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us thank Reverend Seth for such a timely message. When we realize what is going on in our society today, and now we are going to go before God in prayer. Only God can help us. Only God can set us free. And now we are bringing our nation before God. Dear Lord and Master, we pray that the values of life and liberty may truly be our watchword, that all forms of crime and violence will cease in our society. Loving God, you are the author and sustainer of our lives. You know the anguish of the sorrowful. You are attentive to the prayer of the brokenhearted. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need. Strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We pray today for those who have died because of violence, of terrorism. Draw them to yourself. Let your face shine upon them, and may they be greeted with choirs of angels and experience your eternal peace and joy. Dear God, be near to all those who have been touched by violence, those who have been hurt, those who have lost their loved ones or lost their sense of security. Be for them a steady comfort and safe resting place. Soften the hearts and steady of the minds of those who would do violence to others. May hate be replaced with love, violence with peace, and darkness with your light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the peace in our communities. Gracious Lord, we dream of a world free of poverty and oppression, and we yearn for a world free of vengeance and violence. Today we pray for your peace when our hearts ache for the victims of violence and oppression. Help us to remember that you healed people by simply touching them. And give us the faith in our ability to comfort and heal bodies and minds and spirit that have been broken by violence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for justice to prevail in our world. Heavenly Father, when the injustice of this world seems too much for us to handle, help us to remember that you fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And give us hope that what we have to offer will turn out to be enough. When fear of the power of oppression of others tempt us not to speak up for the least among us, Help us, O God, to remember that you dare to turn over the table of money changers, and give us the courage to risk following you without counting the cost. When we feel ourselves filled with anger at those who are violent and oppressive, help us remember that you prayed for those who killed you, and may you give us compassion for our enemies too. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our leaders, Almighty God, today we lift our national leaders in your hand. They carry an enormous burden. The decisions made by our leaders affect the lives of all people across our nation. Lord, they need your touch to lead. Strengthen them. Give them wisdom and grace. Let them speak and act with honesty and integrity in all situations. Give them a glimpse of how much you love them and how much you love your people in this country. Draw our leaders to yourself, Lord Jesus, into an everlasting closer relationship with you. May you anoint them with your Holy Spirit. Speak to them in the quiet moment as well as amid the chaos. May you soften their hearts and make them a true servant leaders. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray against the attack of the church. And now, O mighty and powerful God, God of grace and mercy, we pray to you this day that you will arise in your power and destroy every attack that is waged on the church and body of Christ in our nation and beyond. We know, dear God, that evil powers are very rampant in our society today. Our nations are let go, O God, as they dabble and wobble in things that don't belong to them. And so today, O God, we bring your spirit of destruction against these, the dark forces. We pray, dear God, and we speak, dear God, that you will continue to arise and let the enemies be scattered. We pray, dear God, that you bring your power, dear God, as our Christian brothers and sisters stand up and fight to the last. For we know, dear God, that we fight not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in darkness. And so today, Lord God, your word says, truly they shall gather, but not for our sake they will fall. Lord, we counter every attack that even attack our people, right, O God, in our midst. We pray, dear God, that they will stand and show, dear God, them, you will show yourself to them. And they, O God, will come against everything that is unlike them. So today, the enemy that is planning for the church, the enemy that is planning against the people of the church, that, O God, it will be nullified. The power, dear God, will be against them in and through the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the poor and needy in our society, Lord God, you came to give honor to the least, those forgotten, those overlooked and misjudged. You came to give first place to the last, those left behind, those misunderstood and undervalued. You came to give a warm welcome to the lost, those who are orphaned, abundant and destitute. Today, dear God, help us to be your ears to listen to their cries. Help us to be your voice speaking out love and acceptance. Help us to be your feet walking beside those in need. Help us to be your hand to clothe, feed, and shelter them. You came for the least, the lost, and last of this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who are mentally disabled, Lord God, we pray that we might cherish the gifts God has given them, and in their lives hear the voice, and may their lives hear the voice of our loving God. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we bring our worship to a close as we sing hymn 315, A Charge to Keep I Have, and A God to Glorify.
Brothers and sisters, we want to thank the organist. We want to thank Brother Prosper Clement. Brother Tim is here. James is here. And we thank Jamal, Reverend Anne. We want to thank all of you for your contribution. We appreciate your contribution towards this program. The choir, we want to thank you all. God bless us all. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his light of countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Together may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen and amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
thank you. Have a wonderful week. And we pray that God will give us the grace and always remember to accept people, walk by faith, and stop judging others. Amen.